This Sunday on Close Up, will he be running for president in 2016? And what also does he think about fellow Democrats being so reluctant about jumping into the race at this point? We're going to sit down with former Maryland Governor Martin O'Malley and Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker, getting a lot of attention these days, at least on the Republican side of things. But a political analyst from Milwaukee has to say about this potentially rising star. Morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Josh McKelvin. Now, in recent weeks, I've taken a lot of heat on social media from people who've been asking me, why have I only had Republican candidates on the program? Candidates for president, of course. Answer is simple. There's no conspiracy theory here, save for independent Senator Bernie Sanders, who has been on the show, by the way. Only Republican hopefuls have been in New Hampshire so far, until now. Very pleased to welcome former Maryland governor and Democrat, by the way, Martin O'Malley. Good to see you, sir.
Thanks, Josh. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. So what brings you to New Hampshire?
Well, I'm here in New Hampshire to talk to a number of friends, including Governor Hassan and members of your legislature, because I'm very seriously considering a run for president in 2016. Our country faces serious challenges, and we need proven leadership with a track record of getting things done in order to tackle these challenges, to make our economy work again for all of us. And so that's what I'm here to talk about with the people of New Hampshire and their leaders.
Sure. It surprised a lot of people when Senator Barbara Mikulski decided not to run for another term that you didn't jump at that chance, because you would have been the immediate favorite. So is it fair to say that it was your aspirations on the White House that made your decision for you?
Well, one thing I know at this point, I served as the mayor of Baltimore for about 7 years when our city had some really deep challenges. I served as governor in executive position through the recession and brought our state out of that ahead of other states. So my talents and my interests, I think, are those of an executive rather than a legislator. And there's lots of really good people in Maryland who can fill that seat where Barbara Mikulski served so well for so many years.
As I mentioned just a moment ago, a lot of Republican candidates, potential candidates, have been through New Hampshire in recent months. So I want to ask you about this. I'm glad you're here.
Thanks.
Let me ask you about the perception, real or imagined, that Hillary Clinton is freezing out the rest of the Republican field as she, or Democratic field rather, as she waits to make a decision?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I'll share with you my own thinking. Mm-hmm. If candidates feel they have ideas that will move our country forward, if candidates feel they have something to offer this conversation that we need to be having about how to fix the things that remain broken about our economy so we can get wages rising again, then those candidates should offer themselves and be a part of this conversation. And what the other candidates do or don't do, for my part, really doesn't play into my thinking on this.
So Hillary Clinton's decision has nothing to do with yours?
No, it really doesn't. I mean, I know that I know Hillary Clinton. I like Hillary Clinton. I have a great deal of respect for Secretary Clinton. And at the same time, I feel a responsibility to focus on solutions to the problems that still challenge us as Americans. I mean, our economy's now had 60, that's 60 months in a row of positive job creation, but our wages continue to go down now for 12 years. So we've done a lot of good work, but there's other things that remain to be done in order to move our country forward so a majority of us actually are part of an economy that's working for us.
You know, Hillary Clinton obviously finds herself at the center of some controversy right now. How legitimate do you believe that the criticism is surrounding her use of a private email while conducting state business as Secretary of State?
I'm here to talk about the things that we can do to make our economy work again for people all across our country. I'm really not here to talk about Secretary Clinton or the emails. I mean, I'll leave that to, she's perfectly capable of defending herself and her record, and all of my dealings with her, she's always been honest and straight up with me.
Do you think that as the Democratic front runner, she has a responsibility to explain why she used these emails? You say she's capable of defending herself. Do you think she should be?
Well, I'll leave that to her. I'm not versed in what the federal rules are on emails or what really applies in this situation. What I am concerned about are the economic challenges that face us as a country. I mean, the reason we're able to be envied by countries around the world as the land of opportunity is because of the better choices we've made to make a strong and always growing middle class. And that's what I'm going to focus my energies on, and I'll leave to Secretary Clinton to defend her record, and I'm sure she's capable of doing that.
Do you believe that there is an issue of transparency though, when it comes to this controversy?
Well, again, I'm not here to talk about her. I can tell you that as a mayor, we made Baltimore a leader in openness, transparency, performance measurement, performance management. And I think that is the new way of governing. And that is the way of governing we brought to the state. And that's why we were able to achieve the number one public schools in America 5 years in a row. That's how we were able to make college more affordable by freezing college tuition 4 years in a row. And that's why we created such a fast rate of job creation compared to our neighbors and the highest median income in the nation. So these are the things that are the proof positive, really, of whether or not the choices we make in government deliver results for the working moms and dads that are the backbone of our country.
There are a lot of people who believe, when you look at the Democratic field here in New Hampshire, the primary that hasn't been yet on the Democratic side of things, that, and I don't mean to keep bringing this back to Hillary Clinton, but the reality is she leads by an enormous number up here in terms of poll numbers. But there is pundits feel an opportunity now to come up here because she hasn't been here yet. There is some perceived weakness in her campaign with this new controversy around the emails that no one has taken advantage of yet. So I'm going to ask you point blank, where have you been?
Well, I was here for the JJ dinner, the Democratic Party JJ dinner, in fact, just last year. And I was up here campaigning several times for Maggie Hassan. I think a woman who's been an outstanding governor for your state. In fact, when I was chair of the Democratic Governors Association, we were here big time on behalf of Governor Hassan, and I think she's doing a great job. So I'm not a stranger to New Hampshire. I first started coming up here actually when I was in college, and that's where I met your United States Senator Jean Shaheen. Mm-hmm. She was chairing Gary Hart's campaign in New Hampshire. I knocked on doors in Berlin and Nashua and Concord and all sorts of other great communities here in New Hampshire. So I'm no stranger to New Hampshire. I was here in the midterms. I was here for Governor Hassan, and I'm here now to talk about the better choices we need to make as Americans to make our economy work again for all of us.
So you're versed in New Hampshire's role in the process. What do you think of it, though, being from Maryland and having come up here? Because obviously there's some that feel that we have a disproportionate say in the presidential process.
Josh, you know what I really love about New Hampshire and the people of New Hampshire? And you mentioned poll numbers. I mean, it seems like every cycle there's an inevitable front runner right up until that front runner is no longer inevitable. In other words, the people of New Hampshire make up their own minds. And they're not discouraged or dissuaded or pushed around by poll numbers. They really take their vote seriously because they know they play such a critical role in choosing the next president of the United States. So to those who haven't been here before, I would say that we're actually pretty well served as a nation, that the people of New Hampshire take their responsibility so seriously that they really want to meet oftentimes a couple times the presidential candidates before they make a choice. And I think that's a good thing for our nation.
And as such, do you think that Hillary Clinton or Jim Webb or Andrew Cuomo, any of the names that we've heard, should be here on the ground already letting the voters talk to them, ask them the questions so that the candidates on the Democratic side can start to separate themselves from each other and show some differences for the voters?
Well, I think our party does need to have a robust conversation about the things that we have done and the things we have yet to do. I mean, we've improved the health of our workers, but we've yet to improve the skills of our workers for the new jobs that are being created in this economy. In many cases, you know, we've actually done good things to make our nation safer, but the nature of those threats has shifted and changed, and so too we must change our response. So,
do you believe that conversation is happening?
The conversation's not fully engaged yet on our side, and that can be demoralizing, especially for members of the Democratic Party, because we're only hearing one conversation, and it's all about how quickly we can dismantle our government and how much more we can practice the trickle-down economics of suppressing wages and concentrating wealth at the top. There's a better conversation to be had, and it is the economics of inclusion that understands that the more workers earn, the better that is for economic growth and the sort of shared progress and shared prosperity that, frankly, our parents and grandparents practiced in their own day to make our country stronger for their kids and grandkids.
Sure. This is largely an introduction for you, though. You have been to New Hampshire, but for a lot of people who are taking a look at you as a presidential candidate, this is the first time they're doing so. What kind of Democrat would you describe yourself as being?
Well, I believe that what I would have to offer if I decide to enter this race is a break with the failed policies of the past, really of both parties. Look, unlike some of my older baby boomer brothers and sisters, my politics is not driven by ideology. It's driven by what works to move us forward. That's what I did as mayor of Baltimore. When I was elected, we sadly had allowed ourselves to become the most violent, addicted, and abandoned city in America. And by bringing people together, we turned that around with a new way of governing that focused on the outputs and the performance rather just on budget inputs. We did the same thing at the state level all through the recession, maintaining and defending not only a AAA bond rating, but the highest median income in the country. And we did more rather than less to improve education outcomes for our kids. So my politics is the politics of doing what works, getting things done, bringing people together, and looking over the horizon at the changing nature of the threats we face as a country and being willing to try new and innovative ideas in order to achieve better results. That's what I would have to offer.
Sure, Governor. In an effort to offer a distinction between you and the policies of the current administration, for instance, where do you break from President Obama, say it, be it on foreign policy, health care, areas that obviously generate a lot of attention, especially heading into 2016?
Sure. Well, there's a couple of instances. I mean, look, we have a looming retirement crisis in our country with the way that pensions have been shed in the private sector. I actually believe we need to strengthen Social Security and actually expand benefits in Social Security, because increasingly more and more of our seniors are relying primarily and only on Social Security. On the issue of the refugee children from Central America who risk death and all sorts of horrible things in order to arrive on our doorsteps, I strongly disagreed with the notion of turning those Central American kids back to death gangs and death squads, and said that we should stick with our principles as a nation. We are a generous, compassionate people, and our national symbol is not a barbed wire fence, it's the Statue of Liberty. And I believe a couple of those instances, as well as others, are avenues where I have differed from the president. But let's be honest, look, President Obama inherited a bigger set of challenges than any president in modern times. I think we can't expect him to be a magician and solve all of these things in 8 years. There's work we need to do. We're producing jobs again every month as a country, but we need to get wages moving in the right direction. And we can do that by raising the minimum wage. Another one where I've disagreed with the president is, I think right now, he should raise the threshold at which employees, workers, can actually be paid overtime. That threshold hasn't been raised since 1975. And we need to do things like that right now to put more money into the pockets of the working people of New Hampshire and Maryland and all across our country.
We have a couple of minutes to go. And as you say that you're very seriously considering a presidential run, the reality is to be successful, here in New Hampshire anyway, poll numbers are going to have to move, and there are some out there who believe that there is a reluctance. I mean, you don't want to enter in too much in talking about Hillary Clinton's email controversies that she's dealing with right now, to engage the front runner moving forward. But do you think at one point you're going to have to offer a distinction and perhaps have some pointed discussions with Hillary Clinton in order to sway the voters and have them take a look at Martin O'Malley or any other candidate in the field for that matter?
Well, if I were to enter this race, I think a lot of those distinctions would become very evident in the course of a conversation about the better ideas and the better choices that we need to make as a people. No party's infallible. Our party made some mistakes, and some of them contributed to this huge economic catastrophe that left so many people losing their jobs in my state. I mean, the letters I got from people that were losing their homes, that had lost their jobs. And we haven't completed that job of Wall Street reform that we were, as a party, complicitous in bringing about. What am I talking about? I'm talking about reinstating Glass-Steagall. For 70 years after the crash in 1929, for 70 years, we actually prevented banks from gambling with our money that we were insuring. But in 1999, we stopped that. That was imprudent, and it brought us some pretty bad results. and we haven't fixed it yet. So on that issue and many other issues, I think that differences will become apparent.
Yeah, and it seems to me like you're very ready to have that discussion. Quickly, we're just about out of time, but what kind of timetable have you set for yourself on making a decision on a run?
I've been saying for some time that spring is the time that my wife, Katie, and I will make that decision. And I'm really appreciative of all of the encouragement and support of good friends, and also the hospitality of the people of New Hampshire as I explore and look at the issues ahead of us as a country.
Well, Governor, best of luck to you moving forward. I really appreciate you coming on the show, and it's good to see you.
Josh, thank you.
Welcome back anytime.
Thanks. Good to be with you.
Indeed. And we're going to be right back with a look ahead at another visit by another governor who will be in New Hampshire next week. Scott Walker, stay with us.